as we sing, we have heard the joyful sound. Standing as we sing.
It's hot.
Oh, turn to 361 in your book if you want to know the words. 361.
How's everybody this evening? Did you get you a good Sunday afternoon nap? I hope you stayed inside because it was definitely hot, but I was hoping to get some of that rain they've been teasing us about this afternoon, but it looked like we're going to get any. But hope you had a good day. Just remember all the things that we mentioned this morning before us. I said this morning Tuesday night would be the deacons committee meeting, but that will be the deacon approval committee is Wednesday night at 6. Tuesday night will be our Experiencing God. And just to let you know, if you've gone through your first week at Experiencing God, you can go ahead and start your second week. But we'll be talking about the first week on Tuesday night. So that's no big deal. And if you hadn't got all your units done for the first week, that'll be fine because you'll still be able to catch up. But Tuesday night at 7 o'clock will be our Experiencing God in the social hall. And then Wednesday night will be our missions night, and then we'll do that. And I just got right before church was told that there's a bunch of tomatoes, so Wednesday night at 6 we'll have tomato sandwiches before our missions night. So that ought to get you. Well, that's just sure tough luck. Preacher's going to, all I can tell you is preacher's going to be out of that meeting, okay? I'm going to be eating a tomato sandwich, so. So you might want to change your meeting to be a little early or something, but I'm just saying. But anyway, that's Wednesday night, and thank the ones that'll make that happen. And then you'll see all the other things. Now, just remember Brian Free and Assurance on July the 18th. I hope you remember that. I got to say something. I forgot to say it this morning, and it's a thank you, and I don't know who it is. The guy would not tell me, but I took my lawnmower to Mr. Shipman over at the lake. I went to pick it up yesterday, and he said it's already been paid for. So whoever you are, thank you. Somebody paid to have my lawnmower fixed. So what a great, yeah, I didn't even tell you that, did I? No, you were asleep. But just thank you, and I really appreciate it. And if you're not here tonight, I'll have to say it again Sunday morning, but just what a blessing it was. And I got to, I told Mr. Shipman, if you know him, Charles works on lawnmowers over there. He's going through cancer treatment and going through that, and I told him we'd be praying for him. But just a super guy, second time I've been over there. But just remember him, but thank you, whoever you are, that took care of my bill, paid in full. It's almost like our grace that our sins have been paid in full by Jesus, and my bill was paid in full yesterday there. So thank you, whoever it was. But you can see all the other things before us, and just remember those in our prayer. and we want to go to our prayer time. I know this morning we added Conrad Widener, and then down at the desk, the family of Seth Wright, and then Thursday, Eddie will be going back for his it's CT scan, right, Jackie? CT scan, and then be getting the results back that afternoon, and then what? And then how about others that maybe were mentioned that we need to add to our list? Oh, my. All right. Any others? And Rebecca, you'll be going tomorrow this week and starting her treatment back this week, so let's be praying for her. Also, just remember all the others on our list and that need our prayers. Any other updates or anybody before we move on? If not, we do want to take time to just pray for these and pray for our church and just ask God's blessings upon all of these. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this time that we can come and lift up our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we do just ask your blessings upon all these names that have been mentioned. Lord, especially all these that are from our church. Father, we pray in a special way that you'd just reach down and touch them. Lord, we pray for these that have been added, for Bobby Massey. Lord, we pray that, Lord, that you would just be graceful and merciful to him. Pancreatic cancer is a tough one, and Lord, Father God, we just pray that you just be with the doctors and nurses to just give him the best care. And Lord, of your healing, Lord, we know you're a divine healer, so we pray your healing upon his body if it be your will. Lord, we do pray for Rebecca as she goes tomorrow and has her treatment started. And Lord, we just pray that you just give her a good week. And Father God, that the medicine and the treatment will do what needs to be done there. Lord, we do pray for Conrad. We ask your blessings upon him as he's there in the hospital in Greenville. We just pray in a special way that you just bless him and restore him back real soon. And I do pray for my dad. I just pray that you just be with him. And Lord, many others for these that have lost loved ones, the Ashley family, the Lewis family, the Madden family, the Tophover family, Hoven family, and the White family. Lord, we just pray in a special way that you would just be merciful and graceful and just meet their every need during this time. And Father, we do pray for our country right now. We do pray for our leaders. Father God, we just pray that, Lord, somehow, some way, Lord, you just give us some godly leaders, some leaders that will just stand up and, Lord, just lead us back to you, Father. And Lord, we just pray in a special way for our military men and women, Lord, protection for them and all the land. We know that, Father, there's some that's probably in harm's way that we don't hear about on the news. And Father God, we just pray in a special way for them. We pray for our missionaries. We do pray for Danny and Jordan. We thank you that his procedure went well, but pray that you just continue to just strengthen him. And Lord, I know he's still eating light foods and things like that. So I pray, Father, you just continue to bless his body and just watch over him. And Father, we just thank you again for the opportunity to pray. We pray for our church. We thank you for the blessings of the morning service. And Father, we thank you for all of these that your people who have come back out tonight, Lord, just to, Lord, just do what you tell us to do. It's not forsake coming together. And we thank you, Father, for these that are here tonight. And we know there's some that would be here but can't. And we just pray for them and pray your blessings upon them. And we just ask your blessings upon the remainder part of the service. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
For our offertory hymn, turn to page 511. Stand as we sing the Solid Rock. 511. Oh, what's up there?
Is anybody singing?
Yes. I hope he's better. Jesus' name.
Well, good evening, everybody. The song that I'm going to sing is Take My Hand, Precious Lord, and it's a very old song that I've loved for years. And we all have our problems, one way or another. And we all just need to know that we can just take his hand. He's always with us. And so listen to the words. And I haven't sung in a while, and I couldn't practice before I came, so bear with me. Take my hand.
Thank you, Miss Deb. What a wonderful song. Wonderful song. Hadn't done it in a while. Anybody got a praise report or just something that you'd want to celebrate tonight? Go ahead. Amen. That is so good. Wow. Well, that's good. That's good. Anybody else? Yeah, David. Amen. Amen. And you are walking much better. I tell you, God's good, isn't he? Tell you what, I told somebody today, I said, we'll add them to our prayer list, and we have. I said, because we've got a praying bunch of people that lift up the name of the Lord, and God seems to be answering prayers, and we're going to be talking a little bit about that tonight. Anybody else? Well, thank you. We know what we have to do a lot of times is, I'm a coward when it comes to boldness. I'll just tell you, but God's good. I couldn't do anything. I couldn't stand up here tonight. I couldn't stand up here on Wednesday night or Sunday morning if it wasn't for his grace and his mercy and his strength that he gives me. And it takes getting in the Word, experiencing God. I've done it. So what you guys are going through, I've done it 6 or 7 times, but I just finished the book myself. And I'm excited about going now back through with you guys and worry. So it's good. So I'm excited. And every time I go through it, it seems like, man, I didn't hear that the first time. God speaks new. So it just goes to show you how the Holy Spirit works. Holy Spirit works. Anybody else before we move on? Don't want to leave anybody out. God's good. All the time. That's right. Well, have you ever wondered why your prayers aren't answered? Have you ever thought about that? You know, I was thinking about that this week, and God just kind of gave me, and I'm going to tell you, I got this kind of, a lot of this outline and some of this information from my buddy Charles Stanley, but I thought it was very good for me, and I wanted to share it with you guys. But I put it into a sermon form, and I think it's pretty good. But you know, a lot of times people wonder why their prayers are not answered. And some even give up on praying because they wait and they wait and wait, and it just hasn't worked out the way they wanted it to. And, you know, I think there's many reasons why God doesn't respond to our prayers. It's not that he's not answering our prayers, but there's many reasons why he doesn't respond to our prayers. You know, sometimes I think it could be something in our lives preventing him from answering. Have you ever thought about that? Things in our life that are preventing God from answering our prayers. That happens. And I really believe that. And sometimes I think it's maybe we're making requests to him that don't fit into his will. I think a lot of times the reason I don't get an answer or something, sometimes I'm asking him for something that's just not going along with his will. And he just won't answer. But however, I think there's many other things. And another reason I think that God maybe doesn't answer our prayers is that we may not be praying. And this when I brought this up and when I saw this, Charles Stanley wrote a book about it. And he put it in some of his books. And when I saw this, I had to think about it a little bit, how to put it into words. But another reason for unanswered prayers is that we may not be praying to the one true God. That's where I'm going with this tonight, so go with me with this for just a minute. You see, a lot of times we're praying to a God who we've fashioned according to our own preferences and our own desires. That God is made up, and in our world today, many people have made that God to make and fit their own preferences and their own desires. In Acts chapter 12, verses 1 through 19, and no, I'm not going to read them all, but, oh yeah, I am. I'm going to read them, but I'm going to read it in a little bit different version. Y'all bear with me. I'm going to read it from the Message. And you know, this is where Peter was under heavy guard, and King Herod had done, and he had gotten him up, and he was going to start killing some church people. So here it is, starting in verse 1. That's when King Herod got into his head to go after. Now, just remember, this is the Message. You might be reading from the NIV, New King James, or the King James, so it's going to sound a little bit different, but this is a lot better to understand, and this I like the way they wrote this. That's when King Herod got into his head to go after some of the church members. He murdered James, John's brother. When he saw how much it raised his popularity rating with the Jews, he arrested Peter. All this during Passover week, mind you, and had him thrown into jail, putting four squads of four soldiers each to guard him. He was planning a public lynching after Passover. All the time, that time that Peter was under heavy guard in the jailhouse, the church prayed for him most seriously. Then the time came for Herod to bring him out for the kill. That night, even though he was shackled to two soldiers, one on each side, Peter slept like a baby, and there were guards at the door keeping their eyes on the place. Herod was taking no chances. Suddenly, there was an angel at his side and light flooding the room. The angel shook Peter and got him up. "Hurry!" The handcuffs fell off his wrist. The angel said, "Get dressed, put on your shoes." Peter did it, then grab your coat, and let's get out of here. Peter followed him, but didn't believe it was really an angel. He thought he was dreaming. Past the first guard and then the second, they came to the iron gate that led into the city. It swung open before them on its own, and they were out in the street, free as the breeze. At the first intersection, the angel left him, going his own way. That's when Peter realized it was no dream. "I can't believe this. This really happened. The Master sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's vicious little production and the spectacle the Jewish mob was looking forward to." Still shaking his head, amazed, he went to Mary's house, the Mary who was John Mark's mother. The house was packed with praying friends. When he knocked on the door to the courtyard, a young woman named Rhoda came to see who it was. But when she recognized his voice, Peter's voice, she was so excited and eager to tell everyone Peter was there that she forgot to open the door and left him standing in the streets. I wonder how many of us would have been like that. I've always thought that got a kick out of that. But they wouldn't believe her, dismissing her reports. They were praying for this, guys. And they a lot like us sometimes. But dismissing her report, "You're crazy," they said. She stuck by her story, insisting they still wouldn't believe her, and said it must be his angel. All this time, poor Peter was standing out in the street, knocking away. Finally, they opened up and saw him and went wild. Peter put his hands up and calmed them down, and he described how the Master had got him out of the jail, then said, "Tell James and the brothers what happened." He left them and went off to another place. At daybreak, the jail was up in an uproar. "Where is Peter? What happened to Peter?" When Herod sent for him and they could neither produce him nor explain why not, he ordered their execution. Off with their heads. Fed up with Judea and the Jews, he went for a vacation to Caesarea. I read that and read that way because it's a story, but it's a true story. And you know, when you think about that and we see that, Acts chapter 12, the first 19 verses, record an example of how the Lord answers fervent prayer. Prayers that are used and are serious prayers. You see, his people, they had to learn that. He shows us how we too can pray effectively. Here's the thing. Think about it. Peter's friends were at their home, praying, just praying out loud fervently. They were praying with everything they had, believing that God was going to do something. Well, God did, and it shocked them. Have you ever been shocked when God answered your prayers? You see, when King Herod began to mistreat the believers in Jerusalem and had James put to death, he saw that it pleased the Jews, and we read that, where he said, okay, it pleases them so much, and many of them hated the Christians, and the reason that many of them hated the Christians, they thought they were a cult during this time. They really thought they were a cult, just like we do sometimes. We kind of dislike some other people because we think they're cults. But right here, this was it, and they began to hate them, and so he decided to imprison Peter, and here's the thing. Think about it. I've never really thought that much about it, but there were four guards, two handcuffed to him and two outside the gate. And he wanted to definitely make sure that he didn't escape. Well, here's what I think in the back of my mind. Herod knew that Peter's God was real. There's been some rigged things happen, so he wanted to make sure nothing happened here. So each squad, as they consisted of these two soldiers who were chained to Peter and each on two outside in the squads. Here's the thing, too, I found out this week, that the squads rotated every 6 hours to ensure that Peter couldn't escape. So they were just constantly going over. So every 6 hours they changed. And Herod's whole intention right here was to bring Peter before the Jews after the Passover and put him to death. That's what he's wanting to do. I'm going to do this. But in response to Peter's imprisonment, the Christians gathered together and began to pray. And they began to pray in their house. And as their faith was probably wavering, and here's the thing, and I think it kind of shows that they were a little bit like us a little, is because their faith was wavering a little bit because James had just been killed, okay? So, you know, they got started thinking probably, you know, I don't know if we're going to be able to pray Peter out of this, but God's going to do what he wants to do, and I'm sure it's just like us sometimes, God's will, but really, do we understand God's will? So as their faith was probably wavering because James had already been killed and now they were facing the loss of Peter, here's what happened. Verse 5 sums up the situation very well. It says, so Peter was kept in the prison, but prayer for him was being made fervently by the church of God. Prayer that moves is something that God offers out there. So here's what I think. You know, prayer, I think that moves God is offered to God. It's what I'm trying to say there. Prayers that move God. And this is what we want to do. When we send up prayers, I think we want God to move and we want to move God. But to be able to do that, they've got to be offered to God. And I say that with a big G because that's where I'm kind of going. You see, the first element of effective prayer, I think, is that it be directed to the one true God. The one true God. And you say, well, preacher, that's where all our prayers go. Well, go with me for just a minute because I'm going to take us through this little scenario. You see, right here, the Jerusalem church and all of us who are believers in Christ can confidently bring our request to the Lord because we know the one to whom we pray, right? We know the one we pray. We pray to God the Father, the Almighty God. But however, there's many people today, and sometimes we fall into this trap, that say they believe in God and pray to him, but in reality, their prayers are directed to a deity that they have created in their own minds. Okay? It's this deity of a God with a little g that they have created in their own mind. He's a God, but it's not the God. You see, he suits their lifestyle and is in agreement with what and the way they're living. That he's in agreement with whatever they request. I sent sent something today, and I got a text from somebody way off, and I told him I just couldn't talk to him right now. I don't do that much, but in this situation I did. And I told him I was with my dad at that time, matter of fact. And I said, I'm with my dad, and he's not feeling well. And they said, well, I'm going to be praying for y'all. Well, I don't get me wrong. I appreciate the gesture. And it was a gesture because their prayers were going to this God that I'm talking about, a deity, somebody they have created in their mind that agreed with what their lifestyle was. You see, when we do that, this self-made God, they like it, and people pray it, and sometimes we do, because this self-made God doesn't convict them of sin. This God that they're praying to and people are praying to, and on social media, I know I said social media this morning, I'm on this social media kick. These people that say, hey, I'm praying for you. And they have darted the door of a church. They haven't even really got on their knees. And they hadn't even opened God's word in years. And they're praying to this God that I'm talking about. It's a deity or somebody that they have done. And their concern is not the coming judgment of what God is really going to do to them. Their concern is they can just say, hey, look, it looks good. I'm praying for you. You see, if anyone questions these people that go to this God with a little g about the nature of their God or what they ask of him, they often become very defensive. When you go back to them and say, well, is your God moving? Is your God doing? They get very defensive. What do you mean? You think just because I don't go to church that I can't pray to God? Have you ever had anybody say that to you? Huh? You know, sometimes this is a time that I can say this. Not everybody can take this. But you see, a lot of times when they start getting pushed, they often become very defensive in declaring that their religion is a private affair. My religion's a private affair. Nobody should be worried about me if I want to pray to the God that I want to. It's no one else's business. Well, you know, that's just how people are today. You see, the one true God, and with the big G, is holy and righteous. This one true God hates sin. He hates sin. And one day will judge every person for their sin. You see, this one true God, he's the creator of the world and the one who condemned the earth by sending a flood. Remember? He's that one. He has given us the Ten Commandments. And not as so much as something, but it's really for us to have a righteous standard to live by. He's gave us think about it, the encouraging Psalms of David. He's given us that. He's given us prophecies regarding the future. The future. It's out there. He's given us prophecies regarding the future through his prophets. And ultimately, he is the one that gave his only son so we could come back and have a relationship with him. That's who he is. That's his true God. He gave his son so we could have a savior. So we could have forgiveness of our sin. You see, our God that I'm talking about for me and for you, our God with a big G, loves us unconditionally. You know, he loves us, like I said this morning, when maybe we get a little of ourself and we put ourselves first. When we make a mistake, when we mess up, he still loves us. But let me tell you what, he will not, listen to me, he will not tolerate sin in our lives because he knows it is destructive. You see, we'll carry our sin around and want to continue to pray and think everything's going to be okay. But he will not tolerate sin because he's a holy God. Our God, he alone has the power to answer our prayers and fulfill his promise to give us eternal life with him forever in heaven. That's how he is. And you know, when you think about answered prayers, just think about this for just a minute. The God that we actually are praying to, he sent the flood. He sent his son. He's done so many things through Jesus and a lot of other people. And he's answered so many prayers. And he can change our lives if we'll let him. He can change any situation if we'll let him. And he'll answer our prayers if we'll let him, but we got to make sure that the sin is not blocking our prayers from going to him. You see, in contrast, a man-made God is different than our God. A man-made God has no power to answer prayer, okay? all these prayers that are going up, that they're praying to this God that they have created, a deity that, yeah, they might know about the God, the Father, but that's not the God they're praying to. You see, in contrast, a man-made God has no power to answer prayers and can offer no assurance of heaven. But you see, many people have discounted the reality of hell. This is where many people say, oh, the God that I pray to, he doesn't believe in hell. He wouldn't send anybody to hell. No, he will not. An individual sends himself to hell by rejecting the God. That's how people go to hell. He doesn't send them. He does everything he can, gives us every opportunity we need to be able to accept him and come live with him in eternity. But people choose hell themselves. And you see, many people have discounted the reality of hell and tried to find comfort in saying their God is the one of love. There's some television preachers that stand up and smile real big and say, my God's a God of love. He'll never send anybody to hell. Oh, yes, he will never send anybody to hell, but he will let you choose to go. You see, we need to be reminded of all these things. You see, all their prayers that are being prayed to this God or deity which has no power are useless and have no effect on their lives. I hate to say this, people. Prayers that are sent up to this God that people have made and with sin in our life has no effect. No effect. Prayers that move God is offered fervently. And that's very enthusiastically or passionate. From the heart. Passionate. What have you ever thought about what passionate is? That's with everything you got. You're praying with everything you got. Matter of fact, it's like Jesus was when he was praying in the garden. He had blood drops coming from his body. Blood pumping from his body because he was giving it all he had. That's how we need to be praying. I'm not saying the blood comes, but fervently, enthusiastically, passionately. You see, from a human perspective, there was no hope for Peter this night when these friends were praying. There was no hope for him. Think about it. Man on death row. His head's going tomorrow. He's going to be killed, executed before all the people. There's no hope for him in the world. But in God's eyes, there was. In God's eyes, there were. You see, right here, there was no hope for Peter, who was going to be executed the next day, but God answered the prayers of the Christians who were interceding on his behalf. An angel appeared. I've already said the jail cell came open. Peter was awoke or waking up, or he was told to get up, told him to quickly follow him, the angel said, and immediately his chains fell off. That shows you how God works. God don't have to stumble for the keys at night. He just says, hey, chains, drop off. You remember, he's the same God that created, said, let there be light. And he created this beautiful world just by speaking. You see, immediately as the chains fell off and Peter followed the angel past the first and second guard, went through the gate, which opened by itself, by the way. They wasn't no gatekeeper. God didn't even have to send an angel. The gate just opened. You know, I think about all these things that were happening. I'd been scared to death just watching all this stuff. But you know what? I shouldn't be, because if I was one of those friends praying, I should have been expecting it. You see, Peter, he realized this was not a vision, but he realized he had been rescued by God. Have you or any of us ever been in a situation to where God rescued us from a hopeless situation? We thought there was nowhere to go. And the next thing we knew, God had removed the chain. You see, after making his way to Mary's house, Peter knocked on the gate, but the servant girl answered and was so surprised she ran back in the house where the group was to let people know, but he didn't let Peter in. That sounds just like somebody. But you know, yet the Christians who had been praying so hard, passionately for Peter, they even had a hard time believing, oh, that ain't so. You must be seeing a vision. Had to be his angel or ghost. It couldn't be Peter. But look, what have they been praying for? Guys, this is where I want to stop for just a minute. What have you been praying for? What are you expecting God to do? Are you going to be shocked when he answers your prayers? Or are you going to say, praise Jesus?
Are you going to be the one next time we say, hey, has anybody got anything to say? Let me tell you what my God did. I love the song, and little Tinley, I just keep seeing, let me tell you about my Jesus. I love that. Guys, we ought to be wanting, hey, can I tell you about my Jesus? Peter could tell you, hey, let me tell you about my Jesus. Let me tell you about my God. He just got me out of death row. He just got me out of chains. He just opened the door, and I didn't even have to do nothing. Prayer is motivated by love. Everything God does, I think it's motivated by love. Even when he disciplines us, it's motivated by love. So this prayer that was happening here was motivated by love. Peter's friends were loving him. They had deep concern. That's what our prayer should be about. It should be love and concern. And our prayer should be offered up with enthusiasm, with feeling and faith. It shouldn't be just saying, oh, Lord, I just say to pray that you'll just cover all my friends and just watch over them in Jesus' name. How many of you would answer a prayer like that? That's how we send up our prayers a lot of times. Just blanket cover or something. Shotgun approach. God, but I'm going to tell you what, our prayer should be motivated by the love and concern for people. And also enthusiastic. We should have feeling and faith. I'm going to tell you what, if you ever get around somebody that's got that enthusiasm and can really pray, man, I can just sit there all day. Because they have feeling and they understand what it's about. You see, right here, there was no casual listing of requests. They were just asking for one thing, Peter to be freed. And you see, when we're praying like this with enthusiastic an approach and caring and feelings, this is not some casual listing of requests, but the prayer should be that flows from the heart over a pressing need. I think we all have that. For example, when Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, remember in Luke 22, 24, he was in agony and praying very fervently. He was praying really passionately. I said that earlier. He was giving it, his whole body was trembling. He was giving it his all. You see, it's also persistent prayer that God understands that doesn't stop asking. You remember in Matthew 7:7, it says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. That's the promise that we all ought to understand. If we just ask, God will hear us. And if we just knock on the door, God will open it. You see, that's the persistent prayer. We can't quit asking. You know, a lot of times what I do, and I hate to say it, because if I don't write it down on my prayer journal or keep a journal, I'll ask it on Monday and forget about it on Tuesday. If God don't answer it Monday, it ain't no need in asking on Tuesday. That's not true. God wants to have us praying persistently. Those lost people that we know, those people who are dying and going to hell, we need to not forget about them. 20 years, 25 years, pray till they're either saved or they've already gone out in eternity. That's a persistent prayer. And that's when God answers. You see, we need to remember that because of Matthew 7. He just says, ask and it'll be given to you. Pretty simple. Seek and you will find. Praying fervently for others may involve requests for deliverance from a situation, and we do that all the time, but it could also include praying that the Lord would block or hinder someone from continuing down a dangerous or destructive path. You know, a lot of times we say, God, would you just deliver such and such from that situation, or would you just do this? But sometimes the answer of prayer, God has to remove people from certain things that are going on in their life. Remove them from jobs. Remove them from places they are. Sometimes God has to remove us from dangerous or destructive paths. That's the answered prayer. And sometimes we don't like that. As I said earlier, having that prayer list is very important for us to remember the needs of others. Make sure we're persistent about our prayers. And also remember when God answers a prayer. Let me ask you, when was the last time that you truly remember God answering a prayer that you prayed? That should be pretty simple. But when was it? Prayer that moves God is made according to His will and in an agreement with fellow believers. Uh-oh. Here he goes again, talking about me joining up with somebody else. But when you go into God's Word, it tells us prayer that moves God is made according to His will and in agreement with fellow believers. When we have a burden on our heart, Preacher D, this is going to get kind of hard. But when you have a burden on your heart, you need to be seeking out someone who can pray with you. Don't just pray alone. You need to be seeking out somebody that can go with you. You need a prayer partner that can offer encouragement, can offer support, even guidance. And this is the thing that I like about a prayer partner, somebody that can help you pray about something. They'll hold you accountable. Accountability even in your prayer life. How many of you have that? Well, it's my prayer life and nobody needs to know anything about it. It's not what God's Word tells us. See, according to Matthew 18:19, it says, again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. He didn't say one of you, do it all alone. He said, I say to you that if two of you agree. See, according to Matthew 18:19, God answers requests when two people agree in prayer about anything that is according to His will. Now, it's got to be according to His will. So we see that prayer is the most powerful thing we got, people. Prayer is the most powerful thing we can do. And God desires to answer our prayers when we come to Him with a clean heart. Now, okay, here we go. I knew there was a catch. Guys, you got to have a clean heart. If you're coming to somebody dirty, they ain't going to listen. You come to me dirty and muddy and all this bad breath or whatever, it's going to be hard to listen because you're going to be looking at stuff. God's the same way. He wants us to come with a clean heart because He is a righteous God, a holy God, a pure God, and all He wants us to be is to be holy and pure. That's all He wants. So when we come to Him praying about something with a sin in our life, His ears are closed. You see, sin in our lives hinder our request. The Lord will not answer petitions and our prayers that help us continue down a path of disobedience because that will not benefit us. See, that's the whole thing. When we're going to stay in the same place we're at and we're going to keep doing what we're doing, but we're praying for God to change things, He's not going to answer it because we're going to continue to go down that same path. You got to come with a clean heart. We, therefore, should always seek to make requests according to God's desires, His word, and ask Him to block anything. Here's the thing that we got to understand. Sometimes when we're praying, we got to ask Him to block anything that interferes with His will for our life. We don't like to ask that because He might change some things that we're holding on to. He might change the some things that we like. But we should be praying and seeking and making requests according to His desires. Not our desires. Remember a while ago I was talking about people have made their own God because they want Him to be the God that only hears what they want, their desires? Well, guys, we can't have that kind of God and still have the true God. You see, He's the true God, so we have to pray to Him and make sure that when we ask, okay, Lord, if there's something in my life, if I've got to quit doing this or if I've got to be removed from this or you got to take this from me, God, I'm ready. As long as I'll be able to do what you want me to do. And you see, as we faithfully pray, and He will give us a discerning spirit to know the truth and insight we need for life. When we pray with a clean heart. That's why I say all the time, and guys, let me tell you what. A lot of times I'll jump into my prayer time without even asking God for forgiveness and showing me anything that might hinder my prayers. But every one of us need to make sure because I don't know about you, hot air rises, but nothing happens sometimes in my prayer life because I don't go with a clean heart or sin that God has told me that I needed to repent and change or move from. So as I close, I ask you tonight, are you certain that you're praying to the one true God? That's the first thing I'm going to ask you. What preacher do you? Yes, I am. You know I am. Are you? Or are you praying to the God that you have created? Have you redefined your God according to your desires? That's all I want to make sure. I just want to make sure you're praying to the one true God and not to the God that you have redefined according to your desires. And when you're praying, how does your perception of God compare with what he says about himself in his word, about being holy, righteous? He can't be around sin. Here's the whole thing, and you'll find this out in experiencing God. You're going to find this out in experiencing God. Whenever you go to your prayer life, and whenever you're in a situation, you're experiencing God. When you go to pray, you're going to the throne of holy God. You're experiencing God. Man, what a privilege. And you see, a lot of times, how does our perception of God compare with what he says about himself in the Word? Is he a God of the world? Or is he the God of the universe who created and controls all things? You see, a lot of people are praying to the God of the world, and we know who that is. But my God is the God of the universe who created all things. He controls all things. And he answers all prayers that are lifted up to him with the right heart. So when was the last time you prayed fervently, passionately, really just seriously? I'm not judging anybody's prayer life. I'm just asking. I ask myself this. What was the need when you were praying? And how did God respond? Or has he responded? Does your recent prayers request align with God's will? Or does it align with your desires? Here's the thing. Does it align with God's will? Or does it go along with your desires? I guess sometimes I gotta pray and just seek. How do I know the difference between my will or my desires and God's will? If it doesn't go along with this, or if the Holy Spirit tells us. So I close tonight pretty simple. How's your prayer life? Are you praying to the one true God? Or are you praying to the God that you have made up that just listens to your desires? Where's your heart at? And that's the bottom line. That's all I'm asking. Because I'm going to tell you what, in our life and in our world, we see people praying, but nothing happening. Nothing happening. And there's one of two things. You either got some sin, or you're praying to the wrong God. Point blank. Point blank. So as I close tonight, I'm going to just pray. And I'll challenge you this week to go back and read Acts chapter 12 and just think about what was taking place that night. And then be reminded of Matthew 7:7 and Matthew 18:19. Just be reminded that you have every opportunity just to ask God anything that goes along with his will. Not your desires, okay? Not your desires. Because my desires sometimes don't go along with his will, but what he wants. And just see what happens. See what happens. Father, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for the opportunity of prayer. And we thank you that you do tell us in your word that if we ask, it'll be given to us. And Lord, if we'll just seek, and Lord, seek with a clean heart and a sincere heart and a heart of passionate, Lord, just that we are praying and our desires go along with your will, then Lord, we know that you're going to answer. Lord, I hope that even like I have been reminded tonight that we need to pray. And sometimes we need to involve other people to pray with us. Not only where your word tells us two are better than one, but Lord, it also holds us accountable to make sure we're persistent and making sure our heart is in line with yours. But Father God, whatever it is that you're speaking to each individual tonight, I pray, Father God, that your will be done. Lord, I know that this is a praying church, and I have seen you answer so many prayers in this church, Father. But sometimes we just need to be reminded of who we're praying to. So, Father, as we leave here tonight, we just thank you for all these that are here. And I pray that you just put a special blessing. Be with us as we go. And help us just to see you, hear you, and follow you in a way that would please you, Father. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. Thank you for being here tonight.